We go pray for him this morning. That's what we're here for.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Glory. Thank you. Your glory, Lord.
Wonderful God. Ever present. Help in time of trouble.
Yes, Lord.
Father, we trust you. We love you, Lord.
Yes,
we glorify your name.
Thank you. you're not missing it, I'm going to share something with you. The entire praise service so far today, it's central, it is specific. It's about the goodness of God. It's about His faithfulness. It's about who He is to us. It's about how He loves us, how He protects us, how He builds us, how He lifts us, how He is here with us. And He is majesty. Hallelujah. So enjoy His presence. Don't let this minute go by without thoroughly 100% delighting in Him. For He is good.
Thank you.
we were unlovable. Thank you, Father. Father, as we prepare to receive your word, we ask that you would anoint our hearts to receive, Father. That you would anoint Pastor Sam, Father, to allow you to speak through him, Father. We desire your word, Lord. We desire manna from heaven. Father, we just glorify you. We thank you, Lord, for all that you are doing right this morning.
Good morning to you.
Good morning.
A beautiful day. Yes. I got to tell you, I was half tempted to grab some of the chairs, put them outside, and have service outside. So one of these days, you might see that happen. I'll call Mike, we'll get it done, and we'll have a nice, comfortable sermon, or service, I should say, outside. We are going to have our picnic, as you know. I wasn't sure if they were going to allow us to have the picnic down in the hole over here at Chippewa's Park, but I'm going to try that first and foremost. Anybody in agreement you want to have it there?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so we'll try that. Anyhow, before I get into it, I want to say this. God has laid some heavy-duty stuff on my heart, and it was all based on the fact that I've heard many of you come and approach me and say that God is showing you things. God is showing you visions. He's showing you the insight of what he wants you to do, and you're still at the fundamental position where you're not sure exactly how to get out there and so on and so forth. And I've been praying about it. I've been praying for you. And so God has given me a collective amount of information. And your good fortune, my wristwatch doesn't work. So that means that we could be here all day. Because a lot of the information I'm going to give you is not scripted. It is just going to be coming from the throne room of God. And I kind of enjoy it because it's been a long time coming since I've been privileged to speak prophetically and not have to be a pastor and give you the teachings and preachings like I normally do. But I'm going to give it to you, but I certainly would pray before we get started that you take the back of your bulletin and you take notes, because there's going to be some information I believe that's going to be given to you, and it's going to absolutely equip you for the oncoming of what God is about to do, because he's preparing his church.
Amen.
Amen? And if you don't write it down, it's going to be forgotten completely. But if you write it down, you can revisit the notes, and I believe that you're going to find that God is going to use you in the most prolific way. He's going to kickstart you, and it's going to be a wonderful thing. But we're going to be looking at the title that I have for you is A Virtual Reality. I want to open up real quickly in a word of prayer. Father, we just thank you, and we praise you, Lord, for this day. We thank you, Father, for what you are about to present to us. I would ask that, Lord God, that let me become transparent, that, Father, I would get out of the way, and therefore, Lord, you would say whatever it is you want to say. We give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. With a heart of thanksgiving, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So this morning, I want to talk to you about a time when Satan had shown Jesus, and I should put this on so I'm not screaming up here. A time when Satan had shown Jesus a virtual reality. We always talk about the fact that, you know, when God speaks to us, God gives us visions. And we know that to be absolutely true. There it is. But also, I want you to realize, thank you, We also realize that Satan gives visions as well. In other words, whenever God begins to speak to you and he tells you your call, your purpose, your destiny, Satan will come. He must come to try to deter that vision. He will come to try to blind that vision. The Word of God says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, he comes to blind the mind. In other words, he tries to keep you contained within your little world. He doesn't want you to get excited. He doesn't want you to get so enthralled because God is saying something to you that you will get out of your boat. How many of you know that you're never going to know what God has determined for you unless you step out of the boat?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Say it with me. I'm never going to know.
I'm never going to know
what God has determined for me.
What God has determined for me.
Unless I step out of the boat.
Unless I step out.
If you think about it, Peter would have never been able to do what no other human being before him and or since him has ever been able to do. When he saw Jesus walking on the water, wasn't sure because it was the middle of the night and there was a magnificent storm. He said, "Lord, if it be thee, bid it unto me to come unto you." And Jesus gave him one word. He said, "Come." In that one word, that is the logos of God. That is the vision of God. When God gives you his word, he projects a vision. In that one word, Peter would have had enough opportunity to go all the way out to where Christ was. But he had enough opportunity to step up, step out, and step, we say, upon the water. Amen?
Amen.
He stepped upon the water. No, he didn't. I want you to know that the Word of God tells us that God's Word is a stabilizing force. And it also says that we are to stand upon God's Word. Had Peter just stepped out on the water was absolutely dangerous. It was magnificently storming. The waves were overwhelming. He would have been like a drunken sailor if he would have stepped on the water. But he stepped on the Word that Christ had given to him. Amen? And because he was on the Word, he was stabilized. And if he would have kept his vision on the Word that Christ gave him, he would have gone all the way out to his destiny as to wherever Christ was, and he would have been there with him. But what happened? He saw another vision. He saw the possibility of the torment and the possibility of danger and even death that was surmounting around him, and therefore he began to sink. Two things you'll realize. When Christ called him out of the boat, he didn't go back in and help Peter out of the boat. Peter had to step out on his own volition. He had to step out on his own and make that determination. I'm going to do this no matter what. But the other thing, when he got out there, he saw the supernatural magnificence of God's glory. He began to do something he's never done before. He began to walk above the storm, above the atrocity. But when he got his eyes off of God's vision and he looked at the storm, he began to sink. Christ came to him, lifted him up out of his sunken moment, and brought him back to the boat. He didn't bring him back to him. He brought him back to the boat. So what I want to show you is, when Peter stepped out of the boat, he came to realize that there was a veil of limitation that was trying to keep him back from entering the arena that God had called him to. How many of you know that there is an arena that awaits you once you step out of the boat?
Yeah.
It's called the arena of the impossible.
Yeah.
The arena of the supernatural.
Yes.
The arena of the ridiculous. Something that you can't even imagine what's going on.
Yeah.
An arena of the mysterious, a mystery, something that has been hidden for generations and ages past, that God has created you and called you and only you to go into that arena. Amen?
Amen.
So we come to find that when God speaks, he gives us his word, and therefore for us to see the supernatural magnificence of his divine intervention in our life, two things have to take place. First and foremost, you must step out of your boat.
Amen.
You must step out of your boat of religion and step out of your boat of conformity.
Yes.
And secondly, there is a price that must be paid.
Yeah.
It's a price that must and it will be paid on a lonely moment on a mount of temptation where it's only going to be you and Satan and God.
Yeah.
And I say that because God said, "I'll never leave you nor forsake you." Amen.
Amen.
But when you are on that mount of temptation, that's where it's going to be a very lonely moment where Satan is going to show you the possible damage that he will do to you if you dare step out of your boat and step into the arena that God wants you to step into. He will show you how he will overcome you, overcome your family, overcome your marriage, if you step out of the boat into the arena that God has promised for you to take over. Amen?
Amen.
Church, I'm giving this to you because I want you to know something. I am not exempt from all the spiritual scars that have come over my life. The moment that I had said yes to the Lord, before that I was into a moment of nothing but religion. I went through the religious model of everything. But when Christ began to speak to me, and then I knew what he wanted me to do, it didn't start out that I started pastoring. I started out on a small level. You will start out on a small level. But you do not despise the day of small beginnings. Amen?
Amen.
I started out playing a bass behind in a praise and worship team for many years. And then from there, I started out going out and I was doing gospel concerts. No word, just music. I came back and then I was the head of the Northwest District of the organization I belonged to. And I would have 400 or 500 men, and we would gather 3 or 4 times a year, and I set it all up for us to go to New York or wherever, Chicago. I set all the program up, and that's what I did. And I put my hand to the plow to do it. But then along the way, I started to teach in the church. Then I started to travel, as you know, for 20 years. And now I am preaching. So come to understand that when I was called by God, and every time that I said yes, every time that I was about to step into a new arena, Satan wanted to blister me.
Yes.
And he did. He would come against me, would show how he's going to destroy my family. He tried to hurt my children. He tried to hurt my marriage. He tried to mess me up physically, as he still does today. He tried to hurt my character and destroy it. And every time that I found myself in a stumbling place, how many of you know we will all find ourselves in a stumbling place?
Amen.
Every time you are in a stumbling place, but if you are a child of God and you know that you know that you know that you know who you are and what God has called you to do, you will arise again. And when you arise again, you will arise with a resurrection and glory far greater than anything you've ever had before. And therefore, I'm able to say to Satan, God help you when I get out of this situation. When I remove the cobwebs from my head. Because I am going to have a greater anointing, a greater clout, a greater authority. And I'm going to do more damage to your kingdom like you've never seen this vessel do before. Amen? Satan will come against you. Because Satan obviously wants to give you a different vision to control you and keep you in the boat.
Uh-huh.
God wants you and I to see our future.
Yeah.
He wants you to know your future is bright.
Yes.
Your future is glorious. Your future has power.
Yes.
Your future has no sickness, no disease. You will have victory upon victory upon victory over every situation that goes on.
Amen.
Amen. So we see that there is a battle that is going on in our life. The devil will come and he's going to try to give you a virtual reality. He's going to try to show you that you are not qualified. You are rejected. You are not able.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to remind you of the last place where you had failed and try to tell you that you have disqualified yourself.
Yes.
You're not to be used by God. But God is saying, do not look into the vision of what he's trying to show you. Do not look into it. Look into the vision of what I had earlier shown you. When you look into the vision of what I have earlier showed you, then you are going to be divinely transformed into what it is that I have created you to actually accomplish. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
So with all that said, I want you to turn with me to Matthew chapter 4. We're starting with verse 4. But here you come to find Jesus is about to go from a place of divine communion to where he's about to be transferred to a place called the Mount of Temptation. When you go back to Matthew chapter 3, you come to find that the Father has spoke to his Son. Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist in the River Jordan. When he comes up out of the water, the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord came as like that of a dove that landed upon him. And then a voice came from heaven saying, this is my Son, whom I love, and in whom I am well pleased.
Yes.
Peter tells us in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 17, he says, honor and glory was given to Christ after the resurrection.
Amen?
Amen. Is that what it says? No.
No.
Honor and glory was given to Jesus Christ when the glorious voice of the Father came down from heaven stating, this is my Son whom I love and in whom I am well pleased. The Father was speaking to his Son and giving him directive of what his next course of events was going to be. We believe that Jesus knew the entirety of his life on earth all at one time. No, there's no truth to that. If there was truth to that, then why is it you will find only about 2 weeks before he goes to the cross, he is on the Mount of Olives sweating beads of blood because now he come to realize the cup that he must endure. He recognized the Father showed him on the Mount of Transfiguration when the Father spoke to him again and said, this is my Son whom I love and in whom I am well pleased. It would do you well to listen to him. But at that moment, the Father was showing him the end of his life. And that's why he was overwhelmed by seeing how they were going to beat him, sabotage him, mutilate him. They were going to do everything you could imagine to him. But here at the onset, when he was coming out of the water, the Father spoke to him and he gave him honor, he gave him glory, and he gave him every creative gifting and every creative weapon he would need to go into his ministry. The reason I say that is because if you have a vision from God, that means even though you say, well, I never heard the voice of God, you have a vision from God. That means God spoke to you. He has given you insight and foresight of what he's about to do in your life. That means you have honor and glory that has been provided to you. And God also has given you all the creative giftings and all the creative weapons you will ever need so as to fulfill the obligation of your call. Amen?
Amen.
So we come to find Jesus goes from divine communion to a place called the Mount of Temptation. Before his ministry ever kicked into gear, he had to go through something you and I will go through as well. We will find ourselves on a lonely moment on a Mount of Temptation. And for that reason, I must say what people don't want to hear. And I say it because of experience. The moment you hear the voice of God and he tells you what you're going to do, what he wants you to do, it's going to be the last comfortable day of your life. Because there is going to be an attack that is going to come upon you. At that moment of time, if Satan, when he tries to show you a virtual reality to keep you sustained in the boat, if you conform and keep your eyes on the vision of what he shows you, you will be like Peter. You will sink right where you're at and never follow through and see the reality of what God had intended for your life. Amen? So I want you to write these three very important, impacting points down that you need to hold on to. When God the Father speaks to you, three things are going to happen. You are going to receive territorial revelation, and then you are going to receive territorial confrontation. And then lastly, if you overcome on that mount of temptation where there's confrontation, you will go into the final process, which is territorial occupation. In other words, you're going to find that God is going to speak to you. He's going to show you what I want you to do. I have an arena that I want you and you alone to go into. Whatever it be, set up a tent, go up and hold a sign, play a guitar, whatever, go into the streets. Amen. That is the small beginning of whatever he's asking you to do. But before you actually go into that arena, you are going to find that there is going to be a moment where there is going to be combat. You're going to find that there is territorial confrontation. Why? Because the arena you're about to step into, Satan and his principalities have had ownership of that terrain for tens of thousands of years. And they have people that are bound and hogtied and under a stronghold. They have blinders on these people. They don't know the Lord. They're dying in their unsaved state. But you are the one that's carrying the mail of the gospel that is going to go there and set mankind free. Amen. To heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers. Yes. But Satan doesn't want you on his turf. So he's going to try to combat you. He's going to try to deform you. He's going to try to get you to shut up and sit down. Yeah. Why do you think animals are dying? Mm-hmm. Why do you think marriages are falling apart? Why do you think you're in a place of impoverishment? Why do you think your sickness and disease is infiltrating your body? It's not a coincidence. It's because Satan is throwing a mirrored image at you to get you to say, I quit. I'm not going to go any further with it. That's what he wants you to do. Amen? But let me say this to you. When Satan throws that imagery at you, Satan has already been dealt with at Calvary.
Hallelujah.
Jesus already overcame him.
Yes.
So why do we have to go into this moment of intimacy that we have to go through a time of confrontation with Satan? Because Satan, even though he has lost, he still wants you to believe he's in control. Amen? So he's going to come with everything that he can come with. And if you by chance overcome him because you did not put your eyes on whatever he's trying to show you to try to stifle you, but instead, if you keep your eyes on what God had shown you at an earlier time, and you make sure that you hold on to the vision, then you're going to realize that the power and the violence that was used against you on a lonely moment, on a mount of temptation, would happen to you privately. One day you will overcome, and you will use that power and you will use that violence publicly to destroy the powers of darkness. Can you say amen? So with all that said, let's read Matthew chapter 4, verse 8. It said, again, the devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain and showed him. Everybody say, showed him. All the kingdoms of the world in their glory. When I looked at that, I wondered, what glory is there in the kingdoms of darkness? Why is Satan saying he took him up on a high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory? What possible glory could he feel that Jesus would be anticipating or desiring that he would show him the glory of the worlds? And then I looked up the word glory, and the word glory doesn't mean what you think it does. It means reputation. Satan was saying to Jesus, sit down, Jesus, I want to show you something. I want you to know that I have kingdoms you know nothing of. I stole them from the first Adam. Now I have ownership of them. But I have a reputation in each and every one of these kingdoms that if you by chance come in uninvited, that I have the power, I have the clout, I have the ability to take you out. I don't want you anywhere near. And I want you to know that's what Satan tries to do with us as well. He tries to show us what it is he's going to do to us. Well, I want you to know, Jesus looked away. He would not allow for Satan to veil his eyes. He looked away and he looked and peered into the vision of what his Father had shown him. Therefore, he wasn't going to listen to what Satan said. And when God gives us a vision, our eyes are opened. Our eyes are open to truth. And when we have our eyes open to truth, then you come to realize that God is going to do something amazing. God is going to do something absolutely amazing. But you got to keep your eyes focused on it. But when God shows us something, it is better than the laying on of hands concerning your healing. Better than the laying on of hands concerning your healing. If you remember over in John chapter 7, when Jesus was confronted by his brothers and they said, listen, you must go with us. We're going to go to Jerusalem for the Feast of Tabernacle. Jesus said, I'm not going. And they said, you have to go. If anybody wants to be somebody powerful, influential, then go there and show them the things you can do, the miracles that you can perform. And Jesus said, that may work for you, but that's not going to work for me. I'm not going to go. And they went. And Jesus did go, but he went on his own. And he went there very sheepishly, very cautiously. And as he got nearer and nearer to the temple, then all of a sudden, he hears the people speaking. Some people say he's fooling the people. Other people say, no, he's a good man. Jesus goes right into the temple, and he's confronted with the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And they turn around and they say to him, he said to them, he says, why are you trying to kill me? Why are you trying to kill me? He's telling them the secrets of their heart that he already knows. And they're saying, we're not trying to kill you. He said, listen, when you see the Father, you see the Son. When you see the Son, you see the Father. For I and the Father are one. When he said that, then the truth of what was inside of them came out. And they grabbed him, and they took him to an outer hill, if you remember the story, and they tried to kill him, but they could not kill him because it was not yet his time. It was not yet his time. They could not kill him prematurely. So God has given you a vision. And that vision actually is that God is going to use you, we'll say, in the year 2023. And you keep your eyes upon it, I guarantee you, you will absolutely be used by God. But Satan, if he comes in and he tries to give you a virtual vision of letting you know through a doctor, you have cancer, you only have 6 months to live, you have a crossroad. You either are going to keep your eyes on the vision that God has given you, or you're going to keep your eyes on the sickness and what the doctor has said. If you keep your eyes on the sickness and what the doctor has said, then you are going to sink, you are going to die prematurely, and you'll never see the satisfaction of what God had intended for you. But you need to keep your eyes on what God is saying to you at the time. Amen? Back to Matthew chapter 4, verse 8. The devil took him up on an exceedingly high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. Then look at verse 9. And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you will bow down and worship me. He said, take a look at all these kingdoms that I own. I have a reputation that I can take you out just by blinking my eye. I control people in every one of those kingdoms. But I want you to know something, Jesus. He said in verse 9, all these things I will give you if you will bow down. The phrase bow down is the Greek word pipto. Means make an exchange. I'll show you all the kingdoms that I own. And I'll show you the reputation that I have. But I want you to know that you are welcome to come aboard. Because I want to make an exchange with you. I want you to exchange your pedigree. Exchange your name. Exchange your authority. Give me your power. Give me your influence. And I will give you all these kingdoms and everything that I have ownership of. But Jesus, again, was not about to look into what Satan was saying. He turned his eyes away, and therefore he was not allowing Satan to veil his eyes. Satan will say the same to you. Once you know what your truth is, what the vision is that God has given you, Satan will come along and say, listen, take a look at the world that I own. I will make an exchange with you. I want to make an exchange with you. Your call, your purpose, your anointing, your vision, I want it all. But I'll give you everything this world has to offer. I'll give you money. I'll give you fame. I'll give you title. I'll give you position. I'll give you claim. I'll give you anything you want. Just make an exchange with me. But if you say no to Satan at that moment of time, you will come down from that mountaintop experience, and immediately you will turn water into wine. And you will find that as you go into that territory, into that arena where God has called you, then you are going to find that people that are demon-possessed, demons are going to come out, and they're going to flee, and they're going to flee screaming at your very presence because you have stood your ground and not looked into the virtual reality of what Satan tried to overcome you with. Amen?
Amen.
So I'm going to show you this. Satan sat Jesus down, and he was going to show him the kingdoms, each one that he owned. He was going to open up a panoramic screen, and he was going to let him see what he wanted him to make an exchange for. So he showed him the political kingdom. He showed him the religious kingdom. He showed him the financial kingdom. And he also showed him the physical kingdom. And he sat Jesus down, and now he was going to try to let him know, I have such great authority. You don't want to come in uninvited. And you don't want to come in without making an offer of an exchange with me. So the first kingdom that he opened was the political kingdom. He showed them how the tax collectors, or the Roman soldiers, excuse me, showed them how the Roman soldiers were powerful, immeasurable. And he said, Jesus, if you step into this kingdom, you are going to find that I navigate them. I tell them what to do. And they will come against you, and they will absolutely slaughter you. We will take your life. Don't you dare step into this kingdom. But Jesus looked away. He gazed into the vision of what his father had said to him earlier. You know what he saw? He saw that one day, as he would walk into that kingdom, that there would be a Roman soldier, yes, who would be bowing at the knee of a cross, at the foot of the cross, that he himself would be hanging on. And that Roman soldier would be saying, surely this is the Son of God.
Amen.
He also saw another Roman soldier that was elated when Jesus was going to only but give a word. And at the hour that word came, that his servant would be totally healed. Jesus overcame what Satan tried to stop him with. Amen? So Satan opened up the second kingdom. He showed him the religious kingdom. He showed him the temple and the defilement of the temple, how the people were mocking God, how they were using the temple as a money market. And he showed him the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Herodians. He said, Jesus, if you stand and step into this kingdom, I will have them together with the Roman government. We will lie against about you, and we will take you out, and we will hurt you bad. Don't you dare step into this kingdom without our permission. And Jesus turned around and did not look at what Satan was giving him. He continued to keep his eyes focused on what God the Father had shown him. And he saw something totally different. He saw that one day he would go into that kingdom and he would have a handmade whip. He would go in there and he'd whip at the people that were making a mockery of his father's house, for he saw that the zeal of his father's house was going to consume him. And therefore, he came and he upended them. He went before the Pharisees. He saw himself going before the Pharisees and the Sadducees and saying, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it again. He came to see that there was going to be a living temple that was going to come. And he said to Satan, I am not going to allow you to veil my eyes. I see that it's worth it all. It's worth it all. I am not going to be stopped. I am going to enter this kingdom, and I am going to take control. And I'm not going to listen to anything you have to say. Amen. So Satan was losing. Satan, I believe, was having a nervous breakdown.
Amen.
Wasn't working the way he wanted it to. So he showed him the third kingdom. He showed him the financial kingdom. He showed him the chosen and the elect. How they were being brought to having nothing. He showed them the tax collectors stealing from their own people for the benefit of the government of Rome. He showed them how the people were so impoverished that most of them didn't have houses. They didn't have enough food. They were hurting. They were broken. But Jesus saw something totally different. He would not look into what Satan was trying to show him. He continued to cast his vision on what God the Father had said to him at the River Jordan. This is my son, whom I love and in whom I am well pleased. And you know what he saw? He saw that there was going to be a day where there was going to be a tax collector giving back 4 times the amount. He saw that there was going to be a fish yielding a silver coin, a net breaking, and a boat sinking, demonstrating the prosperity that was going to come to the land because of his very presence in that land. And he overcame. Every time Satan tried to veil his eyes, Jesus said no. He did not look into what Satan was trying to show him. He looked away. Therefore, Satan, he had nothing but hopelessness. There was nothing he could do about it. And finally, Satan opened up the fourth kingdom. It was the physical kingdom. He showed Jesus. He said, take a look at this. He said, I am the author of sickness and disease. Take a look at the lepers. Take a look at the blind, the lame, the hurt, the mute, the deaf, the dumb. I'm the one that can throw this on people. And if you step into this arena, don't think that you are so over me that I can't do this to you. I can do this to you, so don't you dare step out of your boat. And again, Jesus wasn't going to look in his direction. He saw something totally, totally different. He saw that as he went into this kingdom, He saw that the blind eyes were open, deaf ears were open, the lame were walking, the mute were speaking, the deaf were hearing. He saw 12 lepers and he said, go show yourself to the priest. And he saw one day that they would, as they walked away, they would be totally healed. He even saw that there was a woman with an issue of bleeding for 12 years. And she knew that there was no hope for her. And he saw that she was going to now come and she was going to make a proclamation as she got behind him and say, if only I can but touch the hem of his garment, I know that I will be made well. And he saw into the future and saw she did just that. And he saw that there was going to be power that was going to surge out of him. And he was going to turn and say, somebody touch me! Somebody touch me! And it stopped him in his tracks. And then he saw that he gave her the opportunity to give a testimony. Ever so sheepishly she did, but she stood up and gave a testimony. And then he saw that he would say to the woman one day, go, for your faith has made you well. And I believe that Satan didn't know what to do. He was losing. He was losing, and he was cruising. So he showed him another kingdom. He showed him the filth and the immorality. He showed him the debauchery. He showed him the prostitutes, the idolaters, and the religious leaders of the day, how they were also under the chamber of the same evil, provocative spirit that was in the land at that time. He said, Jesus, if you step into this parlor of mine, then I want you to know that I can do the same thing with you. I can cause you to get into the same problem, the same depth of sin as where they're at. But Jesus wasn't about to look at that. He looked away, and you know what he saw? He saw himself, and on the first day of the resurrection, he saw his new glorified body peering back at him as a mirror through the eyes of a Mary Magdalene. He saw that there was going to be a woman that was committing adultery. She was accused of adultery, and they were going to stone her. And he said, woman, he sees in the future. He said, woman, your sins are forgiven. Your accusers, where are your accusers? I also don't accuse you. You are free to go, but sin no more lest something worse happen to you. And then he looked, and as he looked, he saw and put a smile on his face. He saw 120 in an upper room that were going to come, and they were going to be overwhelmed with power when the Holy Spirit would come in like a mighty rushing wind and come and rest upon their heads. And they would begin to speak in other tongues. They would go down from that upper room experience. And they would have the power and the authority of heaven to turn their world right side up. And he saw that that power was going to be infectious. It was going to absolutely span the globe for the next many thousands of years. And many people were going to receive that power. And they were going to go and they were going to walk into the vision that God had for them. And they were going to capture all the people that needed to be captured and set them free. But Satan pushed them a little bit too far. And I'll tell you what he saw. He saw a group of people that were coming called Christians. That were going to be followers of his, that were going to believe in him. And they were going to be the ones that God was going to use. And they were going to be in the highways and the byways propagating the gospel. And they were going to go into the arenas where God had called them to, whether it be small or large. And they were going to go with a fervor, with a flavor of heaven. And they were going to do greater things than even what Jesus did. And they were going to go and they were going to set the captives free. Amen. That's why you and I are here. Because Jesus saw us in advance of what we are to become. Amen? Amen? So if you haven't received a vision yet, this is for you because a vision is coming.
Amen.
A vision is coming. But yes, there's going to be confrontation. But if you do not conform to the imagery of what Satan tries to give you, you will find that you're going to go to the third and final process. The third and final process is a territorial occupation. There's territorial revelation, territorial confrontation, and then there's territorial occupation. To occupy means to seize possession of, threefold meaning. It means to maintain, and it means to populate. To seize possession of, to maintain, and to populate. You seize possession of the territory because you did not conform to the virtual reality of what Satan tried to give you. So now it's yours. But you maintain. Why do you have to maintain? Because now you have ownership of that territory. Because the wolves keep coming. So how do you maintain? You get other people as to who you spoke to and shared the vision that God has shown you, and they are prayer warriors for you. And maybe if they pray, then maybe 3 or 4 or 5, if one can put to flight 1,000 and two can put to flight 10,000, can you imagine if you have 3 or 4 or 5, you can send an entire platoon of the devils of hell packing and send them back to hell. They're not going to get on that territory. But be careful who you have as a prayer warrior. Because if you have somebody that's pretentious, and they're mocking you behind your back and saying things like, God's not going to use him. God's not going to use her. Yeah, I'll pray for you. What happens is you have a division. Where there is a division, that's where you allow for Satan to come in and start all over again.
Yeah.
And finally, as you maintain, then the third and final thing you'll do, populate. You're going to populate. In Luke chapter 8, Jesus goes into the village of the Gadarenes. There's a man up under the rocks hissing and spitting. He's out of his mind. He's stronger than can be. They tried to keep him captured with chains. He would break the chains. Jesus gets out of the boat. He goes into that village and he sees the man up into the mountainside. He goes right up to the man and he says, "What is your name?" He wasn't talking to the man. He was talking to the demon inside of him. And all of a sudden the demon speaks up. The head demon says, "Legion. We are legion." That means there's 1,000 demons in this young man. And then the demon turned around and said, "Son of God, have you come to torment us before our time?" What a joke. They weren't waiting to be tormented before their time. They were tormented when they heard a baby crying in a manger in Bethlehem. They were tormented when they saw the wise men coming from the Persian area, coming and meeting at the house where Jesus would be raised as a toddler. That's why Herod was used by Satan, so as to kill all the babies 2 years of age and younger. But here they turn around and the head demon says, "Son of God, have you come to torment us before our time?" And Jesus, they said also, "If it be thy will, will you send us into the pigs?" Now pigs was the main economy of that land. Everyone owned pigs. That was their money market. And so Jesus simply said, "Go." One word. He didn't put together a 1 hour sermon, a half an hour teaching, 3-point teaching. He said, "Go." Why? Because he had already overcome all the kingdoms of the world on the Mount of Temptation. He had authority, he had ownership, he had power, he seized possession. His disciples with him were prayer warriors, they maintained, and now he says to the demon, "Go." 1,000 demons leave that guy. Go into the pigs, they go into the water, and the people come out of their homes, and they're frantic. They're not concerned that this guy that's been up in the hill that's hissing and spitting and acting like a nut, all of a sudden he's saying, they're not concerned about the sanity of this man, they're concerned about the economy. Our economy has gone down because of all the pigs that are dead. And they come against Jesus and they said, "We want you out of here. You are the very reason why this all happened." And so let me show you what happens here. In Luke chapter 8, verse 38, it said, "Now the man from whom the demons had departed begged him that he might be with him." The young man was out of his mind. He's saying now, he's begging Jesus, "I want to go with you." But it says here, Jesus said to the young man, "Return to your own house and tell what great things God has done for you." And he went his way and proclaimed throughout the whole city what great things Jesus had done for him. He went back into his culture and he reproduced. He populated his household. He populated the city. Paul understood that concept. That's why when he finally left the church of Corinth, he left Timothy behind. Over in Ephesus, he left Titus behind. He left little stop-offs of people so as to keep on reproducing and reproducing. And I want to show you one last thing. Can I have 5 more minutes? How many of you will give me 5 more minutes?
Amen.
5, 10, 15, 20, okay, 20 more minutes. No, I'm just kidding. I don't think my voice will hold out that long. But you come to find in Luke chapter 9, it says here in verse 1, "Then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power," everybody say power,
"power,
and authority over all demons and to cure diseases."
Hallelujah.
What was he going to do? He was about to populate all the other cities. He gave them power Power, as you know, is from the Greek word dunamis. And everybody says that's dynamite. No, it's not. It's, I told you before, it's the wind that holds up underneath the wings of an airplane that keeps you going higher and higher. But it also means warlike energy. He gave them warlike energy. But he also gave them exousia. He gave them authority. Authority is the Greek word exousia, which means to exercise the application of. In other words, you can have all the power that heaven has to offer, but if you don't apply it where God wants you to apply it, you won't win one soul. The problem with it is nowadays, when somebody's about to step out of the boat into the arena that God shows them, they happen to look over at some televangelist and say, I like what he or she is doing. And they try to emulate what that person is doing, and they try to become an imitator of it. But I want you to know that when you are now trying to imitate them, you are no longer the unique individual that God has called you to be. And what happens is you have all this power, but you're not applying it where you're supposed to be applying it. So there's no souls won, and people fall flat on their face. Amen? So he gives them power and authority to carry it on into all the cities and to populate. And finally, you come to find in Luke chapter 10, I'm not going to read it, but in Luke chapter 10, he sends 70 others. He sent 70 others into the various cities. He told them to go, and when you go, don't worry about what you bring, because you've already been equipped. You've already have all the equipping that you'll need. When you go into the city, you go into the city and you find a home, and if they accept you, you let the people know that the peace of God is resting upon this house. But don't go from house to house. You stay in that home and you go out and propagate the truth throughout the city. If the city does not receive you, go out of the city, take the dust off from underneath your shoes, shake it off, and move on. It's really what he's saying. But then you come to verse 15 of Luke chapter 10. Jesus is now on the top of a mountain overseeing the city of Capernaum. When he sees the city of Capernaum, he's praying. He is praying. He's already seized the city. He's praying over the city to maintain it. He's praying over the city to maintain it. But then he sends his disciples, and as they're going into the city, he makes a proclamation, Jesus does, of what he had already seen on the Mount of Temptation regarding the city of Capernaum. He said, and you, Capernaum, who are exalted in heaven, shall be brought down to Hades. It's a holding place. Amen? And he sends them in there. When he sends them in there, verse 17 comes, after they've been in the city for a while, he never tells them throughout all the cities, cast out demons, does he? You never hear him say to any of the disciples, cast out demons. Doesn't need to. But they come back out of Capernaum in verse 17. They say to Jesus, you're never going to guess what? You are never going to guess what happened. Jesus said, what happened? They said, even the demons are subject to us in your name. The Bible said they came back with joy. Well, why would you come back with joy? You come back with joy when you are seeing the demons are fleeing from you and you never had to even lift up a finger or say a word and they flee from your very presence.
Amen.
What was happening here is all it takes is one leader. Jesus knew what he was doing. He overcame on the Mount of Temptation. And because of all the glory that he had received during his time of confrontation, now he imparted it to his disciples. Therefore, he overcame Satan, which means the principalities were also overcome because of their leader. And now when he sent his disciples into the land, the principalities knew that they could not come against the followers of Christ. Therefore, they fled from them. They fled from them. And you know, Jesus gave the fivefold ministry to the church. He didn't give the fivefold ministry to the church, the evangelists, the prophets, the teachers, the pastors, to wear $300-$400 suits and gain money from everybody and anybody, right? But they were put there to put as leadership over the over a group of people, an audience of people, so that they would fight the good fight of faith, so that they would recognize the vision that Christ has, and they would share that vision with the audience underneath. And when a leader, even though they are going to try to, they're going to go through their battle on a mount of temptation, when a leader does not compromise their call, their purpose, their destiny, but they say no to Satan, then they will take the arena, what God has given to that pastor or that evangelist, and then everyone in the audience will follow, and they will gladly just go in, and even the demons will be subject to them. Even the demons will scream out at them. When you go out into the highways and the byways, you're going to find that it's all so easy. But when a pastor gives it up, when a pastor falls short, when a pastor falls prey to immorality, adultery, then the shepherd is struck and the sheep will scatter. The sheep will scatter. And Jesus will get those sheep and put them in other audiences of other churches where there is a person that is honorable before him. Amen?
Amen.
But they came back to Christ and they said to Jesus, you never guess what? You never guess what? Jesus said what? He said, they said to him, even the demons are subject to us in your name. Even the demons are subject to us in your name. We don't understand this. And you know what Jesus said? He looked at them in verse 18 and he simply said with a smile on his face, I saw Satan fall like lightning
Hallelujah.
From heaven.
Hallelujah.
Now I want you to stand to your feet.
Hallelujah.
And I want you to take this song home with you.
Hallelujah.
I want you to hear this, and I want you to sing it,
Hallelujah.
And I want you to sing it with everything within you.
Hallelujah.
Jesus simply said, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Come on, sing it. I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Sing it again. I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Come on now. I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Hold on, Mike. They're not getting it. You're not getting it. You're not getting it. We are not in a cemetery. My gosh. Let me tell you something. You're going to go through a battle. This is why I'm giving this to you. You are going to go through a battle very, very soon. But before that battle, you are going to have a vision. And it's going to be a wonderful vision of what God is going to give you. When you have that vision, you won't come to church like this anymore. Because you're going to be enthralled with the vision. That vision is going to be front and center like a carrot before you. You're going to be excited for what God is about to do.
Thank you, Lord.
But there's going to be a time of confrontation. And what you have to do is you have to recognize what I gave you here today. In the privacy of your life, you have to keep looking away from what Satan is throwing at you. And you have to keep your eyes on the vision. And when you keep your eyes on the vision, yes, you are going to be able to turn water into wine. Yes, you are going to see the magnificence of the glory of God begin to manifest in your life. And when people look at you and they say, what's going on? That's when you can say, you know what? Let me tell you something. I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Say it again. I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Get up again. I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Take that home with you. Take that home with you. I want you to know you're going to be singing that song. You're going to be broad. I'm going to speak to you because I know you have it on your heart.
Amen.
That you're about to go out.
Amen.
Don't even worry about it. Don't worry about how you're going to do it.
Yes.
Where am I going to go? Because he's given you the vision.
Amen.
And there are people in that territory that are waiting for you.
Hallelujah.
But there are principalities that are trying to destroy you right now.
Yes.
And they're not going to get away with it.
Yes.
All you've got to do is keep your eyes on what God has shown you. Because
Hallelujah.
You are about to be catapulted.
Amen.
You are about to go
Amen.
Out.
Yes.
Amen. And you're going to be able to say, absolutely, very soon, you're going to look at your wife in the house and say, you know what, I want to tell you something. I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven.
Yes, Lord.
Father, we praise you and we thank you, Lord God, for this beautiful day. We thank you, Lord, for the sermon that you provided, Father, for the words that you've given us. Lord God, as you went through a terrible battle each and every time,
hallelujah,
and Satan tried to overwhelm you, you gave us the understanding and the example of how we are to walk. We are not to look into the face of what Satan tries to throw us. We are to keep our eyes focused on you, Lord, and on what it is that you have shown us and determined to work for us. And therefore, Father God, we can also come with great joy, knowing that no principality of hell is going to stop us. And we can continue to sing, and we can continue to slap the devil in his face simply by saying, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven in my life. In Jesus' name, amen.